Hi guys, welcome back to Sleeve Saturday. So you know what really grinds my gears? Snobbery in the music industry. Look, Live Aid was an all-round historic event that changed the way the general public and the establishment within the entertainment industry viewed the famine in Ethiopia. Even so, it still contained the same old resentment against elements of classic rock. Sure, Bob Geldof was a true trailblazer, and he deserves all the recognition for the millions raised in cash and awareness. But he dropped the ball when it came to some of the biggest bands of all time, who we failed to see in Wembley that day. The same goes for Bill Graham, who ran the American side of things at JFK Stadium in Philadelphia. There were nearly 2 billion people watching it, so it was a stunning exposure experience for the band themselves. A two-way street. They raised money, and they got their name out there. But it was an absolute disgrace on some of the bands that weren't asked. And in particular, there are three of them, three of which I'll get to. Now look, it wasn't all bad. In fact, it was great at points. Queen gave us one of the best rock performances of all time that left the hairs on the back of your neck standing up. And other huge acts of the time all contributed to great effect. From David Bowie, Madonna, U2, Black Sabbath, Run-DMC, Bryan Adams, Elton John, Paul McCartney, Duran Duran, and of course, Phil Collins, who as we know smashed it on both sides of the Atlantic. Ah, the 80s, when you can simultaneously raise money for charity while sipping champers on a mid-concert Concorde. But what about all the mega acts that weren't there? Well, some were asked to be fair, but didn't show up for one reason or another. Michael Jackson in 1985 was the biggest pop star in the world, so where was he? Well, his press office told the New York Times that he was working on a new project and couldn't leave it. Remember, Michael had co-written the charity single We Are The World, which closed the Philly show that day. The project that was so important that he couldn't leave the studio? Well, it was only the multi-million selling Bad album. No sign of Prince either, who at the time was not actively performing live and effectively had retired his live set. Springsteen, who had also appeared on We Are The World, had played Wembley himself a week beforehand on his Born in the USA tour. He was said to be shattered and not in the mood for playing Live Aid, something he later regretted. Stevie Wonder also declined on the grounds of a lack of diversity and inclusion for African American artists. Fair point, I think he's right. Pink Floyd were in legal turmoil amongst themselves. Boy George of Culture Club had helped conceive the concept of Live Aid following the UK charity single Do They Know It's Christmas 6 months earlier. By his own admission, he was too strung out when the time came to play this gig. Bananarama, also on that single, didn't have a touring band, so didn't play and turned down the invite. Huey Lewis and the News pulled out 2 weeks before the show over concerns of how the dough raised for the charity single was distributed, something he ultimately was right about. But it's such a shame they didn't play because at this point they were so hot off the back of The Power of Love, which was released a month earlier. Billy Joel provided some flaky excuse about not getting a band together. Now look, I believe that from Bananarama, but not from you, Billy. Def Leppard's drummer Rick Allen had just lost his arm earlier that summer, so that ruled them out, unfortunately. Morrissey and the Smiths done the classic indie band thing and blamed the elites of the day for not solving the Ethiopian problem themselves, while putting the boot in at the whole self-absorbed moves and virtue signalling by Band Aid and Bob Geldof himself. Again, they were probably right, and there probably is some truth in there. With all these withdrawals and rebuttals, that left plenty of space for three bands who should have been asked in the first place anyway. And look, regular viewers to this channel may not be surprised by my choices. What the pathetic critics of the time called corporate rock, I call begrudgery. Number 3, Foreigner. The previous year, this legendary rock band had released their fifth studio LP, Agent Provocateur. The lead single from that record was the number one smash hit on both sides of the Atlantic, I Want to Know What Love Is. A gospel choir ballad that would have sounded incredible to the Wembley crowd, who for me would have sang it out loud as much as they did for any Queen song on the day. Lou Graham and Mick Jones were creatively at their peak at this point and red hot. Yet they weren't asked to play Live Aid. It's a travesty. They did do Farm Aid later that year, but let's face it, they missed out on the big one. Number 2, Survivor. 3 years earlier, Survivor held the top spot for 6 weeks in a row with the single Eye of the Tiger, one of the biggest songs of all time and still fresh in the memory of a global audience, you know, thanks to its tie-in with the Rocky movie. A year before Live Aid, they had achieved significant success with their new lead singer, Jimmy Jameson, on the Vital Signs record. Frankie Sullivan and Jim Peterick are the Lennon and McCartney of melodic rock, and they were snubbed like this. It's shocking the lack of credibility Survivor were given at the height of their fame, and even today. I've called that out in another video called Induct Survivor. You can check that out if you like. Number 1, Journey. Steve Perry had also contributed to the We Are The World single, and technically Journey were on a hiatus at this point and promoting solo projects. But Jesus Christ, are you telling me Geldof or Bill Graham couldn't have convinced Steve, Neil and John to come back and play Live Aid? Are you telling me the world wouldn't have sang out in one voice, Don't Stop Believing, which was still a contemporary song at this point and only 4 years old? I mean, come on, they had everything for a global audience. They had ballads and they had rockers. Yet Adam Ant got an invite. It's sickening. Look guys, they are my top 3 missing bands from Live Aid. But I'm curious, what bands or artists do you think should have been on that bill? So let me know in the comments, and don't forget to like the video and subscribe to the channel now. I'll see you next time.